Hello, I'm Professor Von Schmohawk, and welcome to Why You. In the previous lecture, we introduced the class of mathematical expressions called polynomials. Polynomial expressions can define polynomial functions, including the functions that we have studied so far. These include zero-degree polynomial functions, known as constant functions, whose graphs are horizontal lines, first-degree polynomial functions, known as linear functions, whose graphs are sloped lines, and second-degree polynomial functions, known as quadratic functions, whose graphs are parabolas. As we will see in this lecture, the graphs of higher degree polynomial functions can be much more interesting and varied. In this lecture, we will see how the shapes of those graphs are affected by the individual terms contained in the polynomial. A polynomial is a sum of one or more terms called monomials. If we think of each monomial as a separate function, then a polynomial function can be thought of as a sum of these monomial functions. Monomials have the form a times x to the nth power, where a is a non-zero positive or negative constant, and x can be any real variable with a non-negative integer exponent. Although in this example, two of these monomial functions don't appear to include x with an integer exponent, variables written with no exponent are understood to have an implied exponent of 1, and even though x does not appear in the first monomial, a sub 0 can be thought of as the coefficient of x to the 0 power, since in algebra, variables with an exponent of 0 are defined as 1. Monomial functions with even exponents have graphs with similar shapes. For example, let's compare the graphs of x squared, x to the 4th power, x to the 6th power, and x to the 8th power. These graphs have a number of things in common. For instance, they all pass through the origin, as well as the points 1, 1, and negative 1, 1. Another important characteristic of these graphs is that they are symmetrical with respect to the vertical axis. This means that if their graphs are reflected across the vertical axis, they remain unchanged. The primary difference between these graphs is the rate at which the functions increase as x gets further from the origin. As an example, let's compare the graphs of x squared and x to the 6th power. For values of x between 1 and negative 1, we can see that a monomial with a larger exponent has smaller values. However, as x becomes greater than 1 or less than negative 1, a monomial with a larger exponent increases more rapidly. As the exponent of a monomial becomes larger, its graph becomes flatter for x values between 1 and negative 1, and steeper for values of x greater than 1 and less than negative 1. To demonstrate this, let's start with the graph of x squared and see what happens as we increase the value of the exponent. If we make the exponent very large, The graph becomes close to horizontal for x values between 1 and negative 1, and close to vertical for x beyond those values. But even though this graph does not appear to continue beyond those values, if we could graph large enough values for the function, we would see that this graph is continuous for every value of x. But to see much more of this function, we would need a much taller graph. For instance, when x has a value of 1.1 or negative 1.1, the function's value is approximately 13,781. And for x values of 2 or negative 2, the function has a value of more than 1 trillion trillion million. In order to graph this function for those values of x, even if the unit distance on our graph was only 1 millimeter, we would need a graph over 1 trillion trillion million millimeters tall. That would require a graph taller than 100 billion light years, which is considerably larger than the diameter of the observable universe. So far, we have looked at graphs of even powers of x. But what about the graphs of odd powers? Let's compare the graphs of x to the first power, x cubed, x to the fifth power, and x to the seventh power. Just like even powers of x, these graphs all pass through the origin and the point 1, 1. However, instead of passing through the point negative 1, 1, odd powers pass through the point negative 1, negative 1. Instead of being symmetrical with respect to the vertical axis, odd powers are symmetrical with respect to the origin. A graph is said to be symmetrical with respect to the origin if it is unchanged when reflected across both the vertical axis and the horizontal axis. Another way of looking at symmetry with respect to the origin is that for every point A that lies on the graph, there is another point B the same distance from the origin that falls on a line running through the origin and point A. Just as with even powers of x, the primary difference between the graphs of odd powers is the rate at which the functions increase as x gets further from the origin. To demonstrate this, let's start with the graph of x to the first power and see what happens as we increase the value of the exponent. As the exponent becomes larger, just as we saw with even powers, the graph becomes flatter between negative 1 and 1, and steeper for values of x greater than 1 and less than negative 1. And for large exponents, the graph becomes close to horizontal for x values between 1 and negative 1, and close to vertical for x beyond those values. And just like even powers of x, if we could graph large enough values for the function, we would see that this graph is continuous for every value of x. So far, we have seen that the graphs of even powers of x have similar characteristics to the graph of x squared, and the graphs of odd powers have similar characteristics to x cubed. But how are these graphs affected by the value of the monomial's coefficient? To see the effect of a monomial's coefficient on its graph, let's look at three functions, x to the first power, x squared, and x cubed. To start with, let's give each monomial a coefficient of 1. As we previously showed, these graphs all pass through the origin and the point 1, 1. They also either pass through the point negative 1, 1 or negative 1, negative 1. So let's see what happens as we increase the values of the coefficients. As the coefficients increase, the graphs stretch vertically. The amount of stretching is proportional to the value of the coefficient. For example, when the coefficients reach a value of 2, the graphs are expanded vertically by a factor of 2. They now all pass through the origin and the point 1, 2, and either the point negative 1, 2, or negative 1, negative 2. Decreasing the values of the coefficients causes the graphs to shrink vertically. If the coefficients are negative, the graphs become reflected across the x-axis. And just as with positive coefficients, larger negative values cause the graphs to stretch vertically. So far, we have examined the graphs of monomial functions of a single real variable x and saw how the shapes of these graphs are affected by the variable's exponent and its coefficient. In the next lecture, we will see how these monomial functions can combine to produce the interesting and varied graphs of polynomial functions.